each one clips. So when you go to hitting the photos, it'll flash on the screen. So like I'll take, when I put content and stuff and I have pictures that show, I take them right off Instagram. So you just do how you do a little flash photo, how you hit that bottom middle button, the power button, you hit them at the same time.
Yeah.
Do a screenshot and you just edit the, crop it and then keep adding it. So when you take it, you go into StreamYard from your phone. When you go to StreamYard from your phone, you go to brand and just upload the photos or whatever. Now you can upload videos into it as well. So brand? If you want to play a video, you brand. Go into brand. You see where it says brand there?
No, where?
Banner?
It says brand.
Where?
In the, it should be one of the options under, to the side. You see banner and it should say brand.
Oh yeah, I see brand. Yeah.
When you look in brand, oh, it has to where, yeah. So that's where, so if you see something like what Mark Breland got, so the viewers can see it, you just click on that picture and it'll flash on the screen.
Thank you.
I'm gonna read what he wrote.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
For sure. Let me see. So here we go. It says now you can call this the official Mark Breland Speaks. I've had enough. I'm going to say some things here that was reserved for my autobiography. Still, by the book, there's so much more. I'm also going to add a couple of pics. One of a quote from a Daily News reporter where he says, the usual reserved Mark Breland is often quieted unless it's something he's passionate about. So true. And this is one of the subjects that has me very passionate, actually beyond passion. So I'm not giving nobody this interview or use my own platform since I've been open like a can of sardines. On the last podcast I was a guest on, damn, they couldn't even wait till the next show to talk about me. I went on that show with them following my request of no Deontay talk. And it's the same thing with, matter of fact, what people are talking about, he went over to UK. Y'all forget, World Breaker did an interview with Mark Breland as well. But continuing on. But when you've been holding on to something for so long and you're pissed off about it, obviously anyone can push your buttons. And all kinds of shit may come out, but that's not the environment I would have chose to speak on. So here's Mark's take. I'll start backwards from the podcast I just did. Anyone who thinks I can beat AJ or Deontay's opponent at the age of 58 doesn't require a response. At my age, the only fight I will have is one for my life. I ain't getting hit no more. I've had my share of fights. As a fighter with little experience, I'm speaking on what I see. I stand by my words that the skill set and boxing IQ I see on AJ and many of the fighters that my former fighter fought would not get past a few rounds with me if we were in the same era and weight class, obviously. As far as saying Deontay is done, And I'm done. I met with each other. Told you, motherfuckers. He didn't mean that shit. But let me continue. Okay. All right. My bad. All right. So continue on. I don't have no idea of what or where that man's career is going. And I'm not interested in trying to predict his career. The facts are that my time in the coach position with the Bronze Bomber changed drastically in the 12 years since I started with him. When he turned pro, Jay Diaz called me and humbly stated that he needed a trainer for a great prospect that he had at his gym. Boxing goes like this. You walk into the gym, you walk into my gym, I train. Let me see, it skipped. Okay, you walk into my gym, I train you. I found you and sometimes I manage you too. So Jay was seen as the head trainer in the media, but I was only the one on the team with the boxing resume, and I was the only trainer. This was okay with me because of my humility. I didn't have to be the one in front of the camera. I've lived that life. After Deontay became a name in boxing, new members joined the team, and it got to the point where I didn't even have my fighter's phone number. I haven't spoke to Deontay alone in years. The things that I told Deontay to do had to be ran past Jay. Deontay had become untrainable because he was at the point of he knows more about boxing than all of us. So teaching a correct jab was not a priority to learn once he continued on his knockout streak. So a coach can only teach someone if they're willing to learn. We would wait for the champ hours before he arrived at the gym, and Jay would inform us of his move. If he had a bad day, we had to be quiet to not be on the receiving end of his wrath. According to Jay, in an effort to not be fired, and yeah, hitting the bag, jumping rope, and running is not high on the list for him. So if he don't feel like it, he don't. And Jay didn't seem to understand the importance. I go to the next page. Oh, of the importance, understand the importance of those things. So he could make it clear not to ask Deontay twice. If I try to pull Deontay to the side to tell him what I see, Jay made it clear, don't say nothing. You don't want to make him mad. I've watched this man, Deontay, speak to many people very disrespectfully. And although I'm extremely humble and calm, I'm a man first. I stayed on the team because I've been there from the beginning. And I believe with his power and willingness to learn more, he could be a force in the sport. I never thought anything this insane could take place. I should not have addressed who had the water, because that accusation is so asinine, it doesn't deserve a reply. Anyone who knows a tiny bit about boxing knows we're tested before and after a fight. So that's the end of that ludicrous allegation. And then there's the gloves to say, that's the one time I'm glad Jay treated me like I didn't matter. So he does all the head trainer aspects, the witness of the hands. The witness of the hand wrapping, the press interviews, everything where cameras involved, except wrap hands. I'm the one for that. I'm not sure if he knows. In all those years, I can't recall seeing him do it. The last quote of mine I'll stand by is, the rubbish was on the canvas. I don't do much talking in the ring, but with Lloyd Hennigan, I did a Muhammad Ali talking as I beat him up. You just can't be so disrespectful to someone in public or private and not expect to get your ass beat. Now, this chapter of my life/book has come to an end, and I won't be speaking about it anymore. To the ones who know me, I don't need to say anything. And to the ones who don't, I'm not trying to defend such ridiculous, outlandish allegations. Lastly, at that fight, just as many others, we had no cut men because Deontay won't need it. So I'm not a doctor, but I know blood coming out of an ear and dazed eyes could be a brain issue. And power comes from your legs, and his legs were gone. So I made a decision to stop the fight, and I'll do it all again. I have a son Deontay's age. I'm not looking to see him go out on his shield. I hope we all stay safe. There are many bigger issues in the world, and that's why I rock with motherfucking Mark Breland on this. But I'll open the lines, let y'all speak. Yeah. But no, that's why I said in these videos I've been posting, I rock with the old man. Ain't no way I'm going to buy into this old man tarnishing his reputation in the sport, what he means for American boxing. He's a polished American amateur. He's a polished fucking Olympian boxer, and as well as his professional career. So for him to be brought on to bringing us, well, we had decades of no American champion. He's been part of that. And that can happen as a fighter rise into his prominence of not listening, becoming whatever it is, and inside the training camp. And even this shit with JD is not saying JD is a snake or whatever or whatnot, but they lose sight of control to where you're dealing with a star fighter. Sometimes it's hard to control that. Now, whether or not they admit that or not, my issue has been with people bashing Mark Breland like a motherfucking bunch of dick sucking hoes and shit. You don't bash this old man. You let that work between Deontay and Mark Breland, or give it time to breathe. And therefore, they can let time heal these wounds. They hash their shit out. That's the way that shit works. You don't bring confrontation and splits like y'all about to hurt this old man. Y'all don't know shit about this. Like he said, they take tests before and after the fight. If a test ain't administered to show that there's some substance in Deontay's system from a water, you can't blame him for that shit. And then all the other shit, because there's if Tyson Fury has these gloves issuing something in the glove, that shit falls on Jay Diaz. What is Jay Diaz's function within this camp? Besides the fact that Wilder has known him for years for having a gym, people who know more Jay Diaz's history within Alabama sports is he's kind of the centerpiece behind Alabama having a boxing program and a commission out there. So is he powerful out there? What is the damn deal? So to think that he'll deliberately do this shit, I can't rock with it until shit is proven. And I hope he ain't proven as poisoning the dude, but something happened that day of that fight. Something happened that day, and I think it should be presented. If there's evidence against Tyson Fury, fuck a trilogy. Get Tyson Fury to fuck about this sport, like I said. Get Mark Breland the hell about the sport if that's the case of him poisoning water. Get them to fuck about the sport. Fuck a trilogy. Get that loss taken off your record. Clean the sport up. And that's that. So I open the lines up. But once again, Fred, to get photos whenever you come across something, clip them through your phone, go over to StreamYard from the phone, attach it to brand so you start flashing that shit on the screen. But that's all. I'm going to open it up. Yes, indeed.
Hey, Reg, last question. How did you get that runner on the bottom of StreamYard?
I've been wanting, you talking about that banner? That's what I need to ask. I've never tried it, but I think I want to start doing it. So somebody else who does it may hop on and tell you.
Okay, for sure. Thank you, Reg.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. Appreciate Reg the Reader. Reg is the reading rainbow, man. Hey, I would have sounded like, ugh. y'all would have talked about me so bad, man. Man, y'all would have talked about me so bad, man. That would have been hilarious, man. Like, oh, man. So what's on y'all, man? Y'all feel free to respond to him, and this basically extended the goddamn show, you know. But I mean, Deontay Wilder and I would agree with Reg on that. It's gonna have to breathe for a little while. It's gonna have to breathe for a long time, and they'll be able to hash it out a year, maybe 2 years from now. Maybe Deontay Wilder may have to retire, you know, for them to have a conversation, but it may or may not happen. You know, I've only been in Wilder's camp for one day, so I can't comment on training or nothing like that. That's not so to what Breland is saying, I can't comment on it, because when I was there, it was sparring day, and I don't have another day to compare Deontay Wilder's training to. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm not an expert on that. I'm well below a novice at that. So I can't compare and contrast and or analyze it. But, D has never been mad at me. So I don't have no experience in that. I just want to be as honest as I can with y'all. Me and Deontay talk straight. I talk to him like a man. He talked to me like a man. Ain't no buffer, none of that shit. I talk to him how I talk to y'all. I told him I would have stopped. I spoke to him Tuesday after the fight. Shout out to Alicia. Thank you for inspiring me to make the call. I told him I would have stopped the fight too. But I will say this. I was up in the rafters. I didn't see the left hook land. If I would have saw the left hook land on the floor, I probably would have let it go a little bit again. So anyways, man, we got EJ coming in. Then we got TB coming in. And y'all feel free to call in. I totally forgot that. And then we'll open up the phone lines. What's up, EJ?
Yo, what's going on, Fred, man? Good morning to the chat, man. Good morning to you, man. Hey, what's the question? Where did Reggie read that from? What was that statement from?
It's on his Instagram.
Oh, real? Yeah. From Breland, Mark Breland, yeah?
Yes.
Wow. Wow. When was that put up? A couple hours ago?
No, minutes ago.
Minutes ago. Man. Wow. That changes a lot, man. Because, you know, in the UK, when that came out, you know, he was over on The Price is Right with Spencer Fearing and thing. Hey, Novi, yeah, you was terrorizing Tunde. That's why I came over yesterday. Why you terrorize Tunde, though?
No, I'm just having, I don't care. I'm just, oh, 3 hours ago. 3 hours ago. Thanks, Reg, on his Instagram.
Yeah.
No, I'm just I thought it was a terrible interview because that interview was so important from a historical perspective. Mm-hmm. So you can't play with it. You can't play with an interview like that where so much is riding on it. You know, you got millions of boxing fans who's waiting to hear Mark Breland's side of the story, and you're mm-hmm. unprepared. You understand? Yeah. So you want the interview, we desire the interview, but and then you don't do your job as a producer slash interviewer of the interviewee. So that's all.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So after listening to that now, that was actually very clear, clearer than what we heard. And that,
yeah, that statement was better than the interview.
Yeah, it was. Reggie read it out well. Yeah, thanks, Reggie, man. He read it well, bro, you know, and put his thing. He's right. And you know, the thing is, it really does highlight what was going into the camp. And it shows you, obviously, the growth of Deontay Wilder. But then, are we trying to say that the fight, the incompetence in the fight, all came down to Jim Diaz? And why did Mark Breland stay around if that was the case? He felt like he, you know, when he comes in, you need to be quiet, moody. Yo, Breland, at that point, sometimes, you know, he needs to stay for the money. Like, why would you go through that? You know what I mean? Go through that stuff. Why would you go through them sort of thing? Like the fact that he didn't even have his telephone number and all these different people. And that makes sense though, because I remember one time you see in the warm-up back in the day, you see Malik Scott in the warm-up with Wilder and stuff like that, doing stuff, and you're like, where's Breland at? You know what I mean? Where's Breland at? So anyway, let me just get to my point. All this has come out, yeah. And us in the UK, or most of the UK, you know, we was like thinking, oh yeah, when Mark Breland came out, yeah, we knew Wilder was this, we knew Wilder was that. But I think when it all comes down to it, yeah, and when with this the MTK Global affiliated in this situation, anything's possible. You know what I mean? Anything's possible, but At the bottom line is that, is he going to be fighting him in the third fight? Who is Deontay Wilder's trainer? And what's the next step for Deontay Wilder? Is he going to retire? That's the next thing, you know? Do you know what's going on with Wilder's contract? Is he going to be fighting? What's going on with the thing?
I'm just like you. I'm on the outside looking in. I don't know the particulars of it. I just know that they're in mediation.
Mm.
And, hopefully we get an answer soon because... you know, hopefully get an answer soon. I just want to see part three. I want to see part three, and also want justice served because it's no doubt Fury. I'm talking about just the glove aspect. It's no doubt he cheated, man. It's so much visual evidence for me.
Mm. But you see let's go back to the first fight. See what Breland said. He said he didn't listen to me. I think in strategy, Breland brought in. He's the more senior coach in that. Breland told him to do this. He wasn't listening from the first fight. So Breland, if he knew that, he could have left in them terms. You know what I mean? But I'm still processing this information. It is early over here, but thanks, Fred. Thanks for letting you come on. Big up to Reggie. Big up to the chat. And Fred, we have a great show, Fred. I'll probably come on again when I get my brain's more clear. But thanks for letting me come on, Fred. Appreciate it.
All the time.
All right, man.
All right, peace. Yeah, man, we got TB coming back in, man. Man, I appreciate you reading that, Rez. That definitely gave me great insight, man, because very seldom do I get to hear the information. I'm always reading the information. You know what I mean? I might need to hire a reader, man. That shit sounded cool just to actually not. I don't know when's the last time I've not read an article anything like that. You know, it felt cool to intake the information. What's up, man?
Hey, the ticker tape we're talking about.
Yes. How you do that?
Go to banners.
Uh huh.
And then I think it should say create.
Uh huh.
and then type in what you want to say.
Oh, damn, I got it. Yeah, I see
and then,
it.
And then it'll ask you if you want to do a ticker tape, and you click on that, and then you click on show. And then it'll ticker across the bottom of the screen.
I'm probably
the least computer literate individual you want to know. I mean, you say that you will ever.
I love y'all, man. That's why I love y'all.
Now on what Reggie was talking about, what Mark Breland said, and I was touching on this yesterday, but I didn't want to hold the line, so I didn't want to be long winded. If all this stuff that Mark Breland is saying is true, you know, saying these fighters of yesteryear always say, well, we didn't do that back in our day, and these fighters nowadays are not like how we was back then, right? Okay, so if that's true, if Wilder doesn't train, like you say, he doesn't run, he doesn't hit the heavy bag or whatever, why did you stay? Trainer integrity. As, you know, a guy with, you know, say with all your accolades as an amateur fighter, you know, say as a multi-time world champion, and, you know, saying this, that, and the third, you were playing second fiddle, you know, saying to a guy who has none of your credentials or whatever, why did you stay? You were basically allowing yourself to be belittled and basically demeaning the craft that you spent the majority of your adult life or your whole life promoting, if what you're saying is true. So now that you're coming out now, it's only making yourself look even worse. Everything that he says out of his mouth at this point is only proving Deontay Wilder's point in my eyes. Personally, in my eyes, only thing he's saying is everything he's saying is proving Wilder's point. Because if everything you're saying is true, then why did you stay? You could have put in your notice and bounced. You know why he didn't? Because Wilder was his meal ticket. He didn't have no other fighters. And based on this right here, just the optics alone, he won't get another. Not a good one. You know what I'm saying? He didn't ruin himself. The best thing he could have done, well, man, you know what? I don't know what he could have done. I don't know what he could have done. If he had kept quiet, it wouldn't have been good. But opening his mouth was worse. And then on top of that, he said that he did an interview with the notion that there would be no Wilder talk. Okay, why didn't he hit the exit button? He didn't. He stayed there and he indulged in the interview. Okay, so he wanted that smoke. He wanted to say something. He wanted to bash the brother. And that's what he did. He said he would not beat Tyson Fury. At any point, did he say that he told Deed that he would not beat Tyson Fury? No, he didn't say that. So if he believed that, was there any point that he gave his fighter any constructive criticism to try to talk him out of the fight or do anything at all at any point or whatever for his best interest, anything as a champ or whatever to retain the title or anything if that's what he truly believed? Out of his mouth, no, he did not do that. Find the lie. That's what he said, right? That's what he said, Fred?
Yes.
If you are a reigning champ, do you want this dude in your camp?
You You talking about Mark Breland, correct?
Yeah. Based on what he said. Because
he stayed, right?
Because he stayed, and he basically just said what he said.
I get that. Yeah, for sure. For
sure. Do you want him in your camp?
No, for sure. I totally get where you're going. For sure. Yes. No, I wouldn't want him in the camp because of that. Yes.
Uh-huh. No. Mm-hmm. He by his own admission, he's a snake. Mm. By his own admission, he is a snake. So we can take this left, we can take this right, we can take it down the middle of the road or whatever. But if you call balls and strikes, he admitted he is a snake. Mm. The best thing he could have done was not say nothing. Let everybody draw their own conclusions. And just say, hey, I said nothing. But as soon as he opened his mouth, he incriminated himself. His truth was incrimination. He should have pled the fifth. They go to court, they're going to tear his hind parts up. Fleece Johnson loved this dude. And that's all I got, man.
Appreciate you.
Peace.
Feel free. We'll take a few more calls. We'll get DB in here and we'll get out of here. You know what I mean? We broke news tonight. You know what I mean? So definitely can anticipate. What's up, 516? What you got?
Hey, what's up, Fred?
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, this is Best Pugilist. I'm getting back at you.
Thank you.
I'll talk to you in a minute. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, I've seen all this stuff. I got into a little debate. Now, I know Mark Breland personally.
Mm.
You know, up here in New York. I'm from here, New York. You know, I got my little boxing program. Mark a fucking legend up here, man. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? Mark's a legendary dude up here. And I know Mark personally since I was a youngster when he was the fucking man. You understand what I'm saying? Winning gloves, the first man to win the New York City Golden Glove 5 times. And you know, he won everything that you could win. That's why he's considered by me to be the best damn amateur there was. Yeah. That man record was 110-1 as an amateur. And he revenged that one loss he had. And as a person, Mark Breland is one of the most upright men of integrity out of men boxing. You understand? So when Deontay Wilder, my man, everything, and I got mad love for him, family from Alabama and all that. But when he said that shit about that water shit, I was like, he's bugging. Not that motherfucker. That motherfucker ain't do that shit. If it had been anybody else in his team, it could have been somebody else. Because usually the people that do stuff to you like that, if that really went down, it's people that's close to you. Because those be the ones that be jealous of you. It don't be nobody that's from the outside, an outsider like that. It's the ones that be like, it be your family that'll turn on you and do some crooked shit like that to you before somebody from outside of your thing. Because when you get successful, it be the people that's closest to you that hate on you the most. You understand what I'm saying? So as me knowing him, the Mark Breland I know, just like I explained to you, trying to explain to these dudes, that I was talking to on Ego page.
Sure.
The man, like I said, Mark always been a brother of integrity. He got black consciousness and he a brother of integrity. And I keep it 100. I learned this from some inside stuff a while back, way back when he first got that job. Part of the reason why he even got that job, because you know Shelly Finkel was his manager. And Shelly Finkel is managing with Deontay Wilder. Now, Mark made a lot of money, decent amount of money in his career even earlier. Shit, but when we was kids, yo, Mark really was driving around in the damn gold Mercedes-Benz just before the 1984 Olympics, because he was getting it like that. But from what I heard, through people that I know that's close to him, and even him, because some of the things that he mentioned to me one time, my mom, he could be selling dogs and shit. He's expensive-ass dogs. He made some bad business dealings. You know, bad business dealings. So when, for him to get into training, when he got into training and started really training fighters, be honest with you, I was kind of even surprised that Mark got into training fighters fully. You understand? So when he got into it, he needed that job, man, as a boxing trainer in terms of, you know, but it's part of his finances and stuff. So when people make the accusation of him doing something like this, I'm like, first off, that ain't the brother I know with the type of integrity he has. And secondly, look, you working with the top, really, in our opinion here in America, the top heavyweight. As a trainer, one of the most important things to any trainer, boxing trainer, is your reputation. You understand what I'm saying? Because if anybody thinks for a moment that you some crooked-ass trainer, ain't nobody messing with you at all. So it would be imperative people to understand this. Mark Breland, you working with, that's the biggest, he's the best and biggest fighter that Mark ever worked with. Why would you do that? There's no, in order, like I was trying to explain to these dudes, man, in order for him to have done something like that, I'm like, what is he gaining on the other side? You know, what are they going to say? You going to say Tyson Fury and offered him a certain amount of money? Mark ain't living no different than he was. He ain't living no better. He ain't certainly got a whole new car and a bunch of new money or something like that. And so it wouldn't be of no benefit for him to do that to his fighter who he's done developed a good relationship with and some loyalty with. And plain and simple, it's the best fighter he's working with. So if he do that, if he were to do something like that, you're going to tear down the person that you're making your money with and who's potentially going to go higher. Because Deontay Wilder's potential was even higher than it was had you won that last fight. So it makes absolutely no sense to me at all. Because I see nothing that he could have gained by doing that on the other side. And haven't seen him, like I said, he ain't benefiting from that. Only thing he did is it just scarred his reputation. Now, Mark Breland always been a cool, quiet type dude. Cool, quiet type. That's why he didn't really come out the way he could have. But I wasn't really surprised because that's really not his style like that. But I know he applied. I know he's a man of pride. He a prideful dude. And I know that hurt him because he close to that kid. Because when he talk about his connection with Deontay, he seemed like real close to him. So that's going to hurt you when somebody close to you make that type of allegation against you. That's just like you and DB. You and DB tight. Y'all seem to be real close. And then all of a sudden, he made some crazy allegation. You're going to feel away when y'all got a little close. So I just don't see it happening. I know a lot of people who got a lot of love for Deontay, myself included. But that part of it, it just didn't sit right with me at all. Now, the shit with Tyson Fury and them doing shit with them gloves, I feel 100% that shit was done. You understand what I'm saying? Because he got a history of that shit. You know, he got a history of doing some crooked stuff. He done got busted with a glove tampering and things like that. He done got caught using PEDs. So I see that. But as far as that thing with Mark Breland, now, in a way, I'm glad he kind of came out and said something because I wanted him to try to, you know, defend his reputation because, like I said, he's looked at as one of the most, like I said, in boxing, he was looked at as one of the more upright guys, one of the best fighters, one of the best amateurs ever, and a damn good pro, two-time champion. And I just can't really see him getting down like that. Not the brother I know. The brother we looked up to here, always good. A brother of integrity. I just can't see that. And I just don't see no benefit in him doing that to a fighter that is the best fighter he's ever worked with and would have only made his career as a trainer better by being associated with him. You understand? So, you know, I just had to get on there after I heard Reggie read that, you know, and say my piece on that.
Appreciate it.
You know? But I'm going to get back in the chat.
One. All right, who's gonna break the tie? who's gonna break the tie? What's up, man? How you feel?
Good, Fred, man. Keeping the popping here. I see you on this controversial subject here, which ain't really no controversy at this point. Mm-hmm. As far as this Breland thing, I think we all got to take notes of this because sometimes I think you come up with a person and y'all may start something together. and you might be a little bit ahead of them. We never know the motives of what people do or why they do what they do. We can just only take the actions and what they say. That statement that Breland had does not make him look good for a number of different reasons. Because if you notice, this is what I noticed. You tell me if I'm incorrect. When Deontay Wilder fired him, he didn't come out and say he'll never be a trainer again. You know, he never did that. He threw out some innuendos and said he was a snake, but he never dug down into that. So I think sometimes when you get into that type of stuff, those are things that you probably needed to go talk to if you had a relationship with somebody about, mm-hmm. and it just don't make you look good. Because even if you win, you're still going to lose. Because right now, as a trainer, his name, his brand, whatever you want to call it, he's probably never training anybody again with any type of reputation. It's going to be hard for him to do that. And I think at some point, Deontay Wilder, he has every right to fire him for whatever reason. He's the boss, ultimately. He could not like his shoes. He could not like his hair. Whatever the hell the reason is, at some point, he has the ultimate reason to fire him. Now, as far as the water or whatever else he's talking about, I just got to the point, at the point of that, it's gossipy. We're probably never going to know what the hell happened with that. I'd be strong and hold fast to say that it'd be hard for us to ever get the details of that. I would imagine. Let me ask you, Fred, you talked to Deontay a few times. Does he seem a bit hasty, to be overreactionary, a bit emotional?
No, I've never been. I see Deontay Wilder in small units of time. So it's always in a setting where it's normal. So I've never had a disagreement where he's disagreed with me, or he disagreed with me about the stoppage when we had that conversation. But outside of that, it wasn't. I've never had energy. Like, no, never, never, never. And I've had 40 conversations with him, probably, you know. So it's I've never had. So that's why I'm saying I've never seen that side. But I'm not there every day. Every time he sees me, it's like, hey, Fred, I ain't seen you in 3 months. You know what I mean? So, or 2 months, you know? So,
in that circle. So, I mean, if he was a bit hasty or a bit temperamental, I would imagine you would have heard of something at this point.
Temperamental.
To.
No. Yeah. I know Deontay Wilder to be very like, he has that ISO focus. Like, you can see it in, like, you can see it in the interviews as well. Like, he's very ISO focused. And like, you can't get him off of it. Like, you can't, like you saw it in that viral moment, you know, where him and Radio Raheem, you know? So, I mean, he has that, but that's it. Because I remember after the Wilder Fury fight, we went to dinner Monday night. Me, Wilder, you know, y'all don't even know who else was there, but we all went to dinner. And, He just can't believe that he didn't knock him out in the 12th round. He just couldn't believe it. He's sitting there like, and he's in that moment. I can't believe I did not. All I had to do was throw a straight punch. Why am I throwing so wide? And he's literally in that moment when we're having the conversation. And that's it. Like, that's the only intense I've ever seen from him. He's never said, I've never been scared of Wilder. Like, I've never had a moment with Wilder where I was like, damn, I don't want to talk to that nigga.
I bring that up because, you know, some people, when they're running companies, corporations, or they're general contractors, they're a bit impulsive. Mm-hmm. So they'll fire people, lay people off for you know, ridiculous things. And you'll hear about those stories. You know, they'll be a bit impulsive about different things. They might not like whatever the case may be. You might tell yourself it's a bit ridiculous.
Yeah,
that's where I'm going down the road of that ass, because that's the picture that's painted. And I think you got to, we are careful, because I think everybody listening to the show is beloved to Wilder. So we're going to be defensive of anything that he says on that.
Yeah, you're right.
On that sense. Mm-hmm. And I think, too, Wilder, if you look at him as a brand now, if you remove the fighting out of it, if you take his brand, he has built his brand in a correct way that a lot of these younger, these guys can take note of, either right. current or younger, coming into it.
I agree.
I think when you look at the Bob Arians, you look at the PBC, I equate this, I'm going to say this and I'm going to get off. I equate that their monster that they have as far as the stock market. If you look at the market, 20 years ago, they used to look at financials. They used to look at PE ratios. They used to have all these variables there to look at. And back then, you used to have to pay commission fees. You pay one end to get in, one end to go out.
Yeah.
It evolved. So then it went from paying like $10, $20 each commission each way to down to $5 to no dollars. Mm-hmm. And to now where you don't pay anything to make a trade as far as stock. You pay for other things, but you don't pay for that.
Right.
And the evolution of it is nobody looks at PE ratios. Nobody looks at financials. If you got a CEO like Elon Musk, people rocking with you. Mm-hmm. So I think that the evolution of boxing has become that some people's fame or infamy has become bigger than the trainers, has become bigger than the managers. And some of them don't like that because they're not getting the attention. They're not getting the notoriety. They're not getting the credit for it. So when it goes wrong, they just throw their hands. Some of them are throwing their hands up and running away and saying, it's not me. Like the Aram, I can't get that fight. That's him. He don't want to promote. Mm-hmm. You're the promoter, but you can't promote.
Yeah.
He's now the trainer saying, I can't train him because he don't want to be trained.
Right.
So they riding with the vehicle as long as they can ride with it.
Right.
But their older units in a newer vehicle that they haven't figured out how to get in that chair and ride there. So it's uncomfortable for them the whole time that they're riding. They just riding to get that check.
Yeah.
And as soon as they go wrong, they jumping out the chair and pointing the finger back at the person.
Mm-hmm.
That's my synopsis.
Okay. Gotcha.
I'm going to get off, Fred. I appreciate the show,
Thank you, dog. Thank you, man.
All right.
Safe travels. Safe drive tonight. Yeah, you know what's funny? That ISO focus about Wilder is actually what I admire about him, because I'm the same way. Like, I'm the same exact way, like, in terms of the way I express it may be different, but I'm not 6'7" and the baddest man on the planet. You know, I'm more closer to 5'7", you know what I mean? So it's a little bit different, but that's what I absolutely love about it, is that that's who he is. So, oh, we got a UK caller. Got a UK caller. Interesting. Hey, what's up?
Hey, what's going on, Fred?
Hey, how you feel?
Hey, this is DOG.
Hey, what's up, man? What's up? What's up?
I finally called in, man. Let me call in on this here, man.
Thank you.
All right, so listen, this is my take on it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so he goes to talk to an overseas company mm-hmm. about an American situation. The week after, BBC, which is one of the biggest channels in the world, just did a documentary on certain people. That show went out to 68 million people. So it's not coincidental. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He's supposed to know better. So if he's trying to vouch for whatever he's trying to say he didn't do, he went to the wrong people to do it.
Mm.
They all associated. You can't do that. You cannot start off by going to people
right.
who got it out from the person you
I agree.
So many years.
1,000%. No doubt about it. No doubt about it.
Cannot do that, because I'm here and I keep my ear to everything going on boxing. So when you got certain people in the UK that act like they don't know what's going on, there's no excuse. I'm here. If they want to know what's going on, they can go on social media and stay focused on that. So they know. So Mark Breland didn't do himself a favor doing that. He should have went to ESPN. He could have went on the breakfast show anywhere. But don't go on, not when somebody's been under watch for 10 years.
Right.
And now they do a documentary on you. You can't go. You can't go to that. You can't go to them people. Now you look suspect. Nah, you should have just did something independent. You could have went on a YouTube channel even. You could have went to TBV somewhere, anywhere. Not here, because they watching that dude and now you're involved in it like that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You can't do that. So I side with Wilder on this one here.
Mm-hmm.
And all of us been studying this dude. You've been quiet this whole time. This whole time for how many months? Almost a year now. And now you react the week after that documentary come out. Can't do that, bro.
Great point.
You know what I'm saying? You cannot do that. So That's it. And I just read what he said on IG. Mm-hmm. I just read it. You cannot go against what your boss is with. And he said he'll do it again. So that to me says he don't care what Wilder got to say. Bruh, you either follow what your boss say or just respectfully say, you know what, bruh, I can't do this. I got to resign. Mm. I love you, bruh, but I can't see you do that right to yourself. You got to get somebody else in. Wilder would have respected him for that. I would have respected him for that.
Gotcha. Makes sense.
You know what I'm saying?
Makes sense.
All right, but I'm back in the chat.
Thank you, bro. Appreciate you calling.
All right, man.
Thank
peace
you.
Out.
Thank you for calling. All right, peace. Yeah, man. We'll go one more call. Let me get DB in here. But yeah, man, it's I couldn't agree with you more. The optics are terrible. The optics are terrible on Mark Breland's end. You know, you go to oh shit, we got LA. What's up? What's up, LA? Praise Black Jesus. Play Black Moses. What's up, man? What's up? Turn me down in the background. What's up? It's all you. 951.
Hello.
What's up?
Hey, Fred. What's up, man?
Hey, how you feeling? Hey. Yes.
Hey, man. Look, I got one thing that's been bugging me. You know, Deontay got an undying trust in his dude D's. You know,
JD's.
Yeah, JD.
Sure.
You know, yeah. This dude clearly had more access to Wilder than anybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, the fact that he was in that room when those gloves were checked and didn't come up with nothing tell you a lot. And I don't understand unless Wilder, something that Wilder's not saying, why is he so hell bent that it was Breland who messed with Wilder? Because this dude, whatever his name is, he had more access to Wilder than anybody else. But it also seems kind of funny that it's clear that Mark definitely had an axe to grind. He admitted himself they pushed him to the back and treated him like shit. So you know, it just strikes me that where does trust in this dude D's come from? You know, unless it's something he's not saying he knew about Mark Breland, why he's so hell bent on saying this guy did it? And you know, I don't know, man. Hey, I'm back in the chat, bro. Thanks for your time, man.
Appreciate you, big homie. Appreciate you. Plays Black Jesus, play Black Moses. Yeah. I mean, that's a good point. That's motherfucker. See what that nigga did to me. You see what that nigga did to me. You see what you did to me, Riverside. Nigga got me stuttering. Nigga, what the fuck you done did to me? You know what I mean? This nigga done got me stuttering and shit, man. Nigga got me stuttering. Nigga got me. You know what I mean? Okay. Gotcha, big homie. Gotcha. Yeah. You know what I mean? All right, hold up. I'm trying to get something for y'all. I'm trying to get something for y'all. Trying to get something for y'all. What's up, 253? Oh, man. All right. Yeah. So, man. It's. That nigga had me stutter. Y'all saw that shit. He was just, man, he cool, man. Keep. Oh, I forgot the dog. 951. I forgot to hook you up, man. Here, man. Y'all niggas, listen.
Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show. 951. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Stuttering in. Hey, Terrence Bailey. Like yes, yes. Yes, yes, Pastor Paul's. Yes, yes, someone outdid Pastor Paul's. Yes, yes, touchdown. Yes, yes, March 5th. Yes, yes, part two. Yes, yes. What's up, big homie? On God, right?
What's that? What's that, son?
What's up, man? What's up?
Man, I ain't nothing, man. I am right here looking at the fight right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
I need everybody to go back and look at the fight, right? And just keep your eye on Tyson Fury's right glove, man. The shit looks so flat. I'm talking about in real time. Just keep your eyes on his glove. The glove
part, looks round so fight two flat. Or fight one?
Fight two.
Yeah, fight two. Yeah, I'm with that. Yeah.
All right, now I am looking at the fight. This man is walking this man down from round one.
Mm-hmm.
And Deontay Wilder is not, you know what I'm saying? He just looked like something wrong with him, like he's not there.
Mm-hmm.
Just everybody, I want everybody to go look at when they first start out. He looked like he's not there.
Oh yeah, for sure. No doubt. He was blinking and shit. He was like this. I remember that. I saw it on the big screen.
The man that can't punch is walking the person down.
Yep. Facts.
Now when I go to the replay. Oh man. But with the Mark Breland situation, I wanna know why if you felt that way that you couldn't get this boy over the hump, that you know this boy wasn't gonna beat this boy. I'm not gonna take the boy money. I'm referring this to the, what was that, the dude that say he from Brooklyn, the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
He was like Mark Breland, this so-called
friend,
stand-up guy.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
If I can't get this boy past the threshold, why am I taking this money? Why am I still in this corner? If I think this boy not listening to me no more and I can't get him past the hump and he's not listening to me, it's no use for me getting a paycheck if I'm the stand-up guy. It's no use in me just sitting back getting a paycheck.
Right. Right.
And I'm not doing my job.
Right. I agree with that. No way he should have found a way out. You know what I mean? I'm getting sick. I'm getting ill. You know what I mean? Or just tell the truth.
Or just tell him, man, you surpassed me, man. You don't want to listen to me. I mean, you know more than me. Then you need to go get you another coach or you can train yourself. That's what I would have told him. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Anybody that's teaching somebody something and still in their corner and the fighter or whatever you doing, if the motherfucker think he surpassed you, you got to move on. I'm not going to sit there and I can't teach what I supposed to be teaching, or I can't work on what I supposed to be working on. The guy's not listening to me, or in my mind, he's not that good. If I'm working with a product that's not that good and I don't think he's that good, I am getting the fuck on, because I don't like losing. Don't no competitor like losing. Man, what person that's a competitor goes into something knowing they can't win? I mean, you know, that's food for thought, man. I just called that.
No, thank you, Batman. Appreciate it.
Yeah, I was just looking at the fight, and when the replay go on, just look at the replay.
The replay shows it so clear. In between rounds. So clear.
So clear. Mm-hmm. Yep. This shit crazy, man. That boy could have died, man. Them people did that to him, man.
Yep.
So that, man, that couldn't be my brother, dog. Mm-hmm. We've been getting pissed together. We've been going to see this nigga. This shit is past boxing, man. They try to kill this boy, man. Come on, man. How many motherfuckers just died in the ring last year? That shit crazy, man. I mean, the year before last, it was 2019,
yeah,
right?
Three fighters,
yeah.
That I know of.
Yeah, man, that's crazy. Y'all could have really killed this guy, man. Yeah, man, couldn't be me, though, man. I've been having to go into jail behind this shit, man. And people keep on thinking he crying and this and that, man. This is fucking boxing. People can die in this sport. Y'all just keep running around here talking about he's crying and he not crying. Go look at the fight. Go look at this man glove. Just sit there and just turn the TV down. Take the commentating out of it and just look at the fight and keep your eye on his gloves.
Or just look at Wilder's gloves and look at his.
Yeah, look at his. Yeah. Yeah. Wilder's gloves got that oval in it. His gloves don't. Yeah. Look, I'm looking at it now. This shit flat as shit. You can see his, when he balled his hand up, you can see his hand. Mm-hmm. This shit crazy. And people sitting there saying, they can't see this shit. Shit crazy, man. They hate that boy that much to do this shit, man. Yeah. Oh, motherfuckers sure. Mad. Nah, I'm about to break it down for real. Motherfuckers mad that this boy ain't got that much skill, but he has an equalizer. He has something that nobody has in boxing. For 12 rounds. He has something that nobody has in boxing for 12 rounds. A punch that can get you the fuck out of there real fast. And y'all are jealous. Everybody dog this boy. Because he ain't doing it the original way. That he wasn't in the gym from birth and became great. Y'all motherfuckers that mad that the boy how old was he when he started boxing?
1920
and fucking became a fucking
bronze medalist.
One of the greatest heavyweights of all time.
Facts.
And then Mike Tyson and all them. Hey Slim, this is all them niggas dick eaters to me. You know why they dick eaters? Because they never embraced the kid, man. All these fake ass niggas this USA shit. This how I know that USA shit, all that shit bullshit, that this boy is a fucking he went to the Olympic Games representing this country. And nobody's behind him at all. You know, you got the black community. You got the brothers, some of the brothers that love him. But he's a fucking Olympian. He represented this country. Shit, a shame, man. Shit, a shame, man. Man, they don't like him because he, you know what I'm saying? He's built on something, man, that a lot of niggas ain't built on, man. I mean, in boxing. He love his skin complexion. He love who he is. He love where he came from, you know. And they hate him for that, man. Shit crazy, man. And this nigga not hurting the kid, though. He not even hurting him, though. I'm looking at this shit. He not even hurting him. And you know the kid ain't there. Something wrong with him. It's not no punches. Something else is wrong with this kid, man. Because when Whitcomb hurt him, when Whitcomb had him hurt him, what round was that when Ortiz hurt him? 10th, 7th?
8th, something like that. 8th, 7th, somewhere there, yeah.
And he snapped right back out of it. Mm-hmm. So you telling me that the man that never can punch got this man just hurt right here for what round is this? It's round 4. The man hurt him in round 4. And he never recovered. But Ortiz hurt him in the 7th round. He recovered in the 8th, and stop Ortiz in the 10th round. And the man bleeding out his ears, man. This shit crazy, man. If y'all don't believe in the club gate, everyone, please go look at the fight, turn the TV down, and just look at it, and just keep your eyes on the man, right glove. Just keep your eyes on the glove. The whole fight, keep your eyes on the glove. Every time, every chance you get, when it's a clear view of it, just keep your eyes on it and watch, you'll see. Man, that's all I got for you, Fred, man. It's
Appreciate you, Batman.
All right, baby.
All right. Peace, King. Cameron Renfrow, I got a question for you, Fred. Do you think Jared Hurd should move up to 160? Yeah, if he can get the Charlo fight. It seems like he's pretty big for 154. If he go up there, he got to get the Charlo fight. I would go up to 160 for a big fight, and the only big fight is the Charlos. You know what I mean? Hey, what's up?
What up, Fred, man? It's Smoke, man.
Hey, what you got?
Man, about the Mark Breland situation, man, it's like everyone is saying, man, he made himself look bad by speaking, man. And it's like him saying he looked at Wilder like his son and all that, but yet you still continue to take money from him, really doubting his skill and progress. And then in light of Bill Haney stepping down from training his actual son.
Right.
See what I'm saying? It makes him look even worse at this moment. And then with him choosing to go across seas, you know what I'm saying, to do an interview with what most people would consider the enemy. It's like, come on, man.
Right.
Your decision making
right.
is not adding up to what you're saying. So, I mean, it's, you know, like everyone's saying, man, we all love Wilder, man. So it's going to take a lot to make someone think, maybe he got something. Because what he's saying and what he's doing, it's not adding up like he was really, you know, in Wilder corner. So I don't know, man. It's just interesting and it's sad. It's just sad, man, overall. But yeah, man, that's all I got, man.
I appreciate you calling in.
All right, man.
All the time. Thank you, dog.
Yep.
Seven 714. Hurry up before I get DB in. What will Breland say when he's asked this? Yeah, you're absolutely right. What will Breland say? Because he opened up a whole new box of questions, right? Like his integrity as a trainer. You know, so I it's just you know, so this nigga wrote a manifesto. that letter was longer than Christopher Dornier's. You know, man, just do an interview, man. Do an interview and frame the questions, man. And you know, now it's set in stone and it's really absolute. Damn, niggas gonna wake up in the morning. Well, I guess we'll be talking about this tomorrow. I guess we'll be talking about this. Blue blood of the half a hondo. We'll be talking about this at 1 o'clock my time for sure. You know, so that's where we're at. You know, so it's the news of the day. You know, hey, Anthony Joshua ain't made headlines all quarantine. Y'all notice that shit? Yeah, what's up? Yeah, so, you noticed that? He hasn't made headlines all month. Welcome to Blue Blood Sports TV. salute. Yeah. Y'all already know Blue Blood going, oh shit, Blue Blood about to. He was on one today. What did Blue Blood was on one today? Hey, he about to go in tomorrow. Make sure y'all stay locked in the Blue Blood, man, and come back. And we ain't got no guests tomorrow. You know what I mean? So, so, 267, what's up?
Hello?
What's up? Turn me down in the back. What's up?
What's going on, beloved?
Hey, what you got, King?
Nothing much, nothing much. This is TCP calling in, man. And I want to say something. Something in the beginning of Mark Breland's manifesto, as you ugly, put it on. it stuck out to me. And it stuck out to me as a person that's angry.
Yeah, he is.
And resentful. You know, and resentful and angry people, they turn venomous. So that those initial sentences that came out was like very, very telling. You know, he's untrainable. I can't talk to him. I don't know the last time we had a conversation together. Like, I don't care. Remember the last time we had a one-on-one conversation?
I don't even have his phone number.
You're right. I don't have his phone number. So just like Denzel said in his new movie, it's the little things that get you caught.
It's a little thing. He's mad at really the position JD's had.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And instead of working to get, you know, on equal footing with JD or whatever the case is, because they came in the game together, right? Him and JD. Wilder and
yeah, and everybody JD. Came in together. Everybody came in together. Every last one.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Mark joined the team the same time?
Yeah. He said he'd had them since day one. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Oh, okay. Well, mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, but still, you know, you bond more with, you know, with certain people or whatever the case is. For some reason, I think, I, you know, don't quote me on this, but it felt like him and JD had a, like an amicable, you know what I mean? Like
had an amicable hatred for one another.
Like when he first walked in the gym, I believe him and JD bonded and they were training together. I think Breland came on a little later. I don't know how much.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Yes. I'm talking about Breland came as a pro.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. And that gel, that chemistry had already bonded and solidified by the time he became pro.
Sure.
It's like,
sure.
You know, so, you know, the point that I want to stick out is that's, you know, he seemed very, very envious of their relationship and venomous, period. And I've seen it, you know, family, whomever, close friends, all that kind of stuff. Once they feel like you're doing them wrong, even if you're not, and who's to say, you know, we don't know the private relationship, but even if you're not doing somebody wrong, if they feel like they're being done wrong, there's no telling what they'll do to you. So,
right.
Yeah, I'll leave with that, Fred. Appreciate you.
Oh, I appreciate you, big homie. Thank you.
All right, talk to you.
All right, first time calling in, yeah?
Second. Okay. You ain't give me the music.
Welcome to the show!
Nigga, yeah, man, you don't turn down a free plate, nigga, even if you full. You know what I mean? You don't go to grandma's house and say no to nothing. You know what I mean?
Hell no. Yeah.
Appreciate you.
Yep. Yeah, right. Like, well, but I was on when you had the professor.
Oh, Professor Griff?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, from UCLA. Yep.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Jody Armour. Yeah. Shout out to PPD.
Yeah, crazy. Yeah. Black
yeah, Armour. Salt and pepper. Salt and pepper fro. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right.
Peace.
All right, beloved.
All right, peace. Cool, man. Thank you, man. Thank you for calling in. Did that nigga just whisper one? What? Did y'all hear that shit? DOG, my bad. I'm so used to talking to you on the motherfucking on the Instagram. My bad, dog. My bad. I took it for granted, man. I took you for granted, dog.
Welcome to the show.
Oh, man. So, yeah. See you tomorrow, Dre's Finds. You got to get up and go to work at 5. Appreciate it. 714, man. We got you. We finally did it, man. We finally. See, this. It's all you, seven. It's all you, Ray. Ray. It's all you. I just clicked on you, man, and you just another 4-hour show. I knew this shit was going to add another hour and a half to the show. I knew it, man. I fucking knew it. See, Deontay Wilder, man, we can't have no more new Deontay Wilder news while we're doing the show. Let that shit break when Blue Blood or 78 is live, you know? Let them do that shit. Let them take care of that shit. Oh, man. All these LA people calling in, man. What's up, man? What's up? Nigga. 951, what's up? All right, I was trying to be nice because you get 300 days of sun just like me, but you want to play funny. 951, when you call in, you got to listen to the phone, not the computer. You're 8 seconds behind. So, but yeah, I know you get up at 6. Oh, you get off at 6:30. Oh, so you cool now. You straight. You know what I mean? You straight. You at work right now, vibing. 3:30. You got 3 more hours. You good. Yeah. Yeah, man. It's something happened in that camp where Mark Breland believed he had no power. It could have been a placebo. It could have been real. I don't know. Maybe, you know, like I think D said they didn't even talk. So maybe that's the problem. You know, maybe they're. All right, what? You got it this time, man. You got it this time, man. You figured it out.
Maybe that's the problem. You know, maybe they're.
See, look at this nigga. 951.
You got it this time, man. You got it this time, man. You figured it out.
951. What's up? All right, I'm done. I'm done with 951. All right, you gonna have to email me. I'll read it. You gonna have to super chat it in, dog. Hey, but yeah, it's something happened where Mark Breland felt like he lost everything, you know, and there's something. And let's just call it a buck, you know what I mean? Let's just act like we're really in the barbershop and just say this shit. Nah, nigga, I'm done with you. Done with you. So at the end of the day, Mark Breland is an Olympic medalist, the greatest amateur in the history of the sport. JD's has an accent, or not, yeah, has an accent, has a southern drawl. He's white. He's training a black heavyweight champion. Every time he went to work, it just like compound interest. And then he's like, and it never broke him because he probably would still be working. You know what I mean? If Fury hadn't cheated, but it's something there that bothered him. You know what I mean? It's something there that bothered him, and he just should have said it in the letter. Now he's going to have to write another manifesto because he definitely didn't say everything what he really, really wanted to say. So, but, you know, at the end of the day, well, man, wish him well. I can't waste all my energies saying I wish something bad happens to you. Now, I wish Mark well. And he had the biggest check in boxing. That was the problem. He had the biggest check in boxing, you know? So now I don't know. That's, see, I only know D in very casual settings. I've been, now I'm not going to say that word, but I've been in like private settings with him. I gave him a ride back to the hotel from a party. It was whose party was it? I shall not say whose party it was, but we were at a party, and it was in Vegas. We've hung out, and I've never. You know what I think of D? Like D is that best friend. Like if we in, you know what I mean? If we got to fight, we got to fight. You know what I mean? If we could think our way out of it, we got to think our way out of it. You know, I think he's that. And I've never been on the business side with him. And maybe he's very shrewd businessman. And, you know, But at the end of the day, Mark Breland should have left. Mark Breland has a level of animosity towards JD's. I feel it. I see it. And maybe JD's has a sense of pride and ownership. I don't want to use the word ownership with the white man and the black man, but you guys understand what I'm saying. So maybe JD's gets the last word in the conversations and shit like that. And it takes a toll on you. You know, like, how does this dude get to do all this? And I'm the Olympic medalist. You know what I mean? I know Shelly Finkel. Shelly Finkel was my man, you know? So it's all this, you know, it'll work his way out. Y'all will be able to put the pieces together in between the interviews. Like the next, JD's got to do another interview, you know? Wilder's going to do another interview. Mark Breland's going to, he ain't going to be able to not talk about this. Deontay Wilder got 10 more fights left in his career. you ain't going to be able to run from a Deontay Wilder question. You know, I mean, if you want to keep your brand alive, Mark Breland, you know, you got to answer it, you know. So and that's just the truth. So that's it. DB, man, call me now, man. What's up? What's up, bro? I guess 714 gave up. So we'll just close the show with DB. DB will do a great job at bringing this all home. Land the plane for us, DB. Land the plane for us, man. And oh, they're going to hash it out, Reggie Owens. Oh, I don't doubt, but it won't be in the near future. And check this out. You know, as Reggie Owens was reading that letter, how about if the water was already tainted? And no matter who would have gave him the water, or not, unless they went out and got the water. Maybe I'm being extreme or something, but hey, what's up, DB? What you got?
Hey, 714 was just trolling, man.
Oh, was it? Around. Oh, okay.
Yeah, just because they from the soil, we still got some weirdos out here too. Shit. All you got to do is walk down Hollywood Boulevard.
He was probably calling from there. You know, he was from in between Western and motherfucking Violin, whatever that shit is. What's up?
It's only about 13 or 14 people that's saying out in the 714 anyway.
Facts.
No, I was just thinking, man. I was thinking about integrity for a second.
Okay.
And then I started thinking about this. I started thinking about let me do it in my blue blood. Undefeated, undisputed, Nigerian legend, future Hall of Famer, Muay Thai standout, technical striking genius, soon to be light heavyweight holder, UFC middleweight champion, Israel Adesanya. So Izzy, when he first started fighting, right, he's undefeated, he's undisputed, he's the middleweight champion right now. But when he first started fighting, he went into the gym and saw his coach, Eugene Behrman. And, you know, I don't know, I think he trained for like 1 or 2 days or whatever. But he had a fight and he needed somebody to corner him. So he said, hey, can you corner me? Gene was like, no problem. What is your rank in jiu-jitsu? You know, what kind of striking do you have or whatever? So anyway, he went to the fight and, Izzy was good standing up. He could strike, but he had a wrestler that just, you know, took him down and basically pinned him down for the whole 3 rounds and won a decision. Izzy couldn't do nothing from the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
So when the fight was over, Gene was like, you know, sometimes they'll give the check. I mean, you probably know that. Sometimes they'll give the check to either the coach or to the manager if they don't see the fighter. So they handed him his check. He gave him the check, and he was like, peace out. You know what I'm saying? And Izzy went to the gym, you know, a few days later and was like, hey, what's up? He was like, dude, I can't train you. You understand? He was like, I can't train you. Like, I don't have nothing for you. You know what I'm saying? He was like, but there's a lot of good gyms in the city. You know what I'm saying? You know, try those gyms out and see how those other gyms work out for you. You know what I'm saying? And Izzy did. He left and he went and did some free trials for a week or whatever. So several weeks later, he came back and he was like, you know, those are some cool gyms, but like I'm going to train here. You know what I mean? And fast forward to now, you know, he did have something to show him, obviously, because Izzy went almost undefeated. I think he has 100 kickboxing matches, you know, with 4 losses, I believe. And I'm sorry, he's 80-4 in kickboxing and he's undefeated in MMA. But the point is, with the integrity factor, when he first got there, he figured, like, you know what? There's nothing I can show you, so try somebody else. That's my whole point. You understand? So when we start talking about Mark Breland, that I think that's the point that everybody's getting to now. And, you know, sometimes it's better just to keep your mouth shut and just have people speculating, because when you open your mouth, now you subjected to be critiqued or criticized. You know, he should have took the Al Heyman route and just stayed in the background,
right.
But since he opened his mouth, now he put himself on the chopping blocks. So, yeah, now he's got to deal with it, you know, because now every time he talks, people are going to look for any chinks in his armor. And, you know, anything you say can and will be used against you, you know, in on these platforms. Mm-hmm. So, and, you know, he's got to think about it now, too. New media outdoes old media. And mm-hmm. as you said, too, there's no boss. Right. So you can ask whatever the fuck you want to, how you want to.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? So you don't have to think about it's not like, I have to have this person come back, or I have to worry about what, you know, Fox is owned by Disney and Mickey Mouse is your fucking boss. And you got to, you know what I mean? You don't have to watch your steps. You can say whatever you want to say. So when these guys come on these platforms, man, you're going to be asked these questions. So yeah, he put himself out there. So, you know, he's an elder, you know? So, you know, I respect him as a
black man. Yeah, we definitely would do that for sure.
As a black man and as an elder, but outside of that, you know, what they say in the UK, I think my brother DOGG215, I think it's a chat shit get smacked or something like that. You know what I'm saying? But like, yeah, you came on here, you put yourself on a chopping block, so let it be what it is, you know? Yeah, but yeah, that's it, man. You know, I want this shit to get resolved. Listen, if you're not coaching anymore, be on your merry way. And work with whoever you want to work with. You want to work with Fury? No problem. He can't stop the fucking right hand from landing. You understand? So right. You can go work with him if you want to. You know?
I definitely could see that happening, though.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's his home gym, too. You know what I mean? Those are his people over there crunk shit. I'm thinking of somebody else who was doing that. I remember John David Jackson. When he was training Andre Ward, I'm sorry, when he was training Sergey Kovalev, and he met with Virgil, he had a phone call, remember that, with Dre and Virgil,
yeah,
about coming over to train him for the second fight.
Yeah,
it can happen. I wouldn't be surprised, and I don't think many of us would be surprised if we saw Mark Breland over at Crunk Training, you know. But yeah, man, I like fights. I like a whole bunch of fights, man. For me, I would like to see guys fight, you know, no less than 3 times a year, somewhere between 3 to 5 times a year, you know. That's what I would like. So I want to see Deontay Wilder in the ring as soon as possible. Yeah, I want that title shot, but I also got a lot of motherfuckers who need their heads knocked off. Need Big Baby Miller to get his head knocked off. I need him to decapitate Dillian White. What's the Nigerian name, the youngster now talking crazy?
F.A.
Jogba, you know, he got to get it. What's the receiver that used to play for the Denver Broncos?
Oh yeah, crazy? Yeah, Brandon Marshall.
Brandon Marshall. Yeah, this dude needs to get impaled. Like, these dudes need to get fucked up, and it's a check for Deontay Wilder. And what he's going to do is he's going to knock these dudes out somewhere between 1 and 5, you know, and then those other fights will come. The AJ and the Fury. Look, you're going to either fight me or retire, but ain't no way you can get around me, you know, because I'm going to be ranked in whatever sanctioning body, IBF, the WBO, WBA, WBC, somewhere. And I think if Mauricio comes here again, you know, talking with us, it's just people, period. It's just going to be enough pressure on him to have to sanction that fight and get that fight.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, but fuck FA, man. That was some weird old.
Yeah, that was weird to me, dog. Like, how you gonna let some, and then you gonna let someone talk for you? You know what I mean? Like, don't be that guy. You're a heavyweight, dude. Don't be that guy, man. Say it. Say how you really feel. Right. Say it. Don't repost it. Say it, nigga.
AJ needs to catch that fade too. He'll end up getting it. But it's funny, and I don't mean to switch real too drastically, but young lady asked a question yesterday and we didn't get a chance to get back to it. But I think a part of that question she put in the chat or in the super chat kind of goes to this right here. And I think Reggie had her on his show yesterday. I was busy, so I didn't get a chance to slide over to Reggie's for too long. But this is that separation, I think, that she was talking about. You know what I mean? Like, listen, okay, you are African that's born in Africa.
Mm. Oh, yeah. Right?
And so you say he's a disgrace to Africa? You piece of shit, you. You know what I'm saying? This is where that separation comes from. Now, luckily, you know, D has a, you know, he's got a strong spirit and he believes in his culture and has a sense of self-identity and self-love and whatnot. But if he didn't, you know what I mean? This is where that, this is where the rift could be with creating dissension between two different cultures, but the same people, you know? So fuck F.A. Ajogba for that right there. But, you know, I don't like to let dudes off the hook, you know, now you got to squabble with me now, homie. You know what I'm saying? You talked about my sister. Somebody told me, well, you got to squab with me. Oh, yeah, but he said, well, you got to squab with me. You know what I'm saying? You looked at my brother crazy. You got to get down with me. Yeah. So, yeah, that was just weird. And salute to Franz Okendo. Man, I've been chopping it up with him ever since the interview was over. We've been chopping it up. We've been on Instagram chopping it up for the last 2 hours.
Oh, man. Really? He's still up? Yeah, what the hell are you doing?
Franz, man, cool people.
Oh, man. I'm about to follow him right now.
Yeah, y'all go do that, man. Yeah,
everybody go follow Franz Okendo and put a barbershop sign in there. Why not?
And while you at it, man, I got your fingers on there, man. Please drop that link for the GoFundMe for the awards.
Oh, yeah, man. Y'all got to do that, man. What are y'all doing, man? What y'all on? Why y'all not? That nigga had me stuttering today. Y'all, you see that shit? Stuttering is contagious, nigga. I didn't know stuttering is contagious.
Yeah. Yeah, John Page, that was some clown shit, man. For real. Yeah. My brother DOGG215, man, represent Philly. He out there representing for us, man, in the UK.
Yeah, appreciate you, man. Kenneth Johnson. Kenneth Johnson was our live donor. Thank you much. Thank you much. Thank you much. Yeah, go ahead and drop a cup of coffee in there, man. We on our way. We gonna get there.
Yeah. Jared 011 Green, salute to you too. And I got my cousins up in Pittsburgh in the Yay area, man. Hardline Boss and my cousin D Man Jr. Yeah. What's up, family? But yeah, what else, man? What else? Yeah, I don't like to spend. I don't even like to give. I don't want to give him too much pub because this is what he wanted. You know, that it's that old Eazy-E shit. You know, whether it's bad pub or good pub, it's still free pub. Mm. You know, and if Mark Breland is trying to sell a book or, you know, trying to build his brand, like don't do it. Don't do it by trashing Deontay. That's just, if anybody knows, he should understand more than the majority of people roaming the face of the earth that this dude has some undying love. His fans have some undying love for him. You know what I mean? Like, it's unconditional. Deontay Wilder is a different breed of a person. Fuck just being in the ring. Mm-hmm. So people going to ride for him. And you being, you know, one of the coaches, you got a chance to see this shit. You know, so you should be very wise, or as Farrakhan say, be very wise and careful as you select those words.
Right.
Yeah. Where are we at, man? Everybody hit that like button, man.
Yeah, smash the like button, man. Smash the like button.
Yeah, smash the like button. Reggie Owens, you going live? Reggie O, you going live? What time we at right now? It's 1 o'clock again. Look at you, Fredro. God,
man, we having a 30-minute show tomorrow.
Yeah. shit. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. All right, man. Well, let's go on and give some love to the fan band, man. Before we get out of here tomorrow, it's just us. No guests, right?
Just us. Yeah, just us. Oh, and, yeah, just us.
Talk shit and swallow spit.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah. San Diego in the house. Young Merv, the cup, man. I see you. The queen, she done went and turned it in. Patty Dean, oh, yeah. I ain't seen any chat in a minute. All right, good stuff right here. All right. Freya, come on, man. You got to give a few people some love, man, before we
before we hit the road.
Hustler Slim gets some love. The Reading Rainbow gets some love. Joe James gets some love. Lil 95 gets some love. Be Good gets some love. Everybody gets some love.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. All right, man. My cousin D-Man Jr. in the building. Pittsburgh up, in the house. Yay, area. Be Good. I see you, my bro, Joe James in there. Joe James, I don't know, man. I don't know if I've seen you, but welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Texas in the building. Texas. Peace, my brother Cletus. I see you. Bumpy Thompson. What up, big bro?
How about Stone?
Anthony. Stone and Anthony. Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
OG, Big Unk, Dre Finest in the building. Hustler Slim. Mr. Tennessee himself. He said 100. Hardline boss representing the whole top of the state for us, man. Holding it down. Cause old Lil 95 down here representing, better believe it, and you know it, Mr. Money Mac. Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Ooh, my brother Picasso in the building. Let me see. D Will, I see you in there, man. Let's see Cletus. He said the show was fire. Good job.
It was a good show tonight. It was a good show tonight, man. Very like it was, we had a 5-hour flight from LA to New York. No turbulence, man.
Damn, I just noticed the sweater too. Lil 95 just mentioned it. Yeah, that sweater hard as fuck.
What, my sweater? I'm the only sweater y'all can see, nigga. Yeah, man. Lambert Park, man. It's hand stitched, man. You know, I got it at Soul Folks. I got it at Soul Folks, man.
Nice.
It's like $80. Soul Folks.
I'm with it. Yeah, every time I go out of the state and got out of the country, I don't really wear my LA stuff here. Well, that's a lie. I got a gang of shit. But whenever I go out of state,
always. Yep.
Yeah, I'm Lakered up, I'm Dodgered up, mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. LA Kings, facts. Like shit, all that.
Facts. Facts.
UCLA.
Facts.
Yeah. Let's see. Kai, you said Portsmouth, man. Do I say that right?
Portsmouth, Virginia, nigga. 757, man.
Yeah, you remember homeboy had you stuttering this that shit right there. Give me tongue tied.
Portsmouth. Yeah.
Going to the DMV. Yeah, let's see.
Yeah, my problem was my problem is that I don't know which hoodies to take. That's my problem. What hoodies? I gotta be narrowing it down before I be traveling.
Yeah, I like to travel light too. Mm-hmm. Let me see. Jared 11 said Texas by way of North Carolina. Okay, you like them country towns, huh? Mm-hmm. Right on. Salute to our kin folks. Mm-hmm. Let's see. Nathan Lyveld, or is it Lyveld? All right, Nathan. Well, welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Ray Meraz. Maras. Is that a Latin Maras, Hispanic Maras, or is that an Ethiopian Maras? Anyway, Ray, welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Keep him in here, man. He don't like Wilder, but it's cool. Wilder let his fans down. It's okay.
Oh, that's that 714 right there.
Oh, that's the one so he'll call in tomorrow. I'll call in tomorrow. I'm interested.
It don't make sense. You don't like Wilder and put 714 right there.
I know. 714. I mean, yeah, he getting all those benefits from Biden right now.
Yeah. Damn, the Yay area in here thick. Yova, you up in the Yay area?
Yay area. We be to rap what key beat to lock what we be.